Hello everyone and good afternoon, very good afternoon to all, and I welcome you all to the our session of heat transfer. So for last three lectures we have been discussing about very fundamental aspects and various terms and conditions, terms and definitions actually taken from the thermodynamics, and particularly in last lecture we covered the modes of heat transfer, that how heat transfer occurs. So the basic modes of heat transfer are conduction, convection and radiation, and all those processes of conduction, convection, radiation, how it happens, and that we saw in detail, and also explained with some examples. And lastly we ended up on with the explanation of solar water heater, where we get to see all modes of heat transfer in action. Let me present my screen so that you will have a clear view. And I hope that my voice is clear and loudly reaching to you. I have just started the screen sharing. I hope it is visible to you, to your end. If you have any trouble in viewing the screen or regarding any audio problem, you can give your feedback through messages. You can simply give your reply in the message box, and thereby I can get your feedback. So I hope you are able to see whatever I do on screen. So we ended the last lecture with the example of solar water heater. In this we saw and we learned how heat transfer processes occur across all three modes. So this is very simple simple common example. Nowadays solar water heaters have been installed on in our homes at many places. These solar water heaters are being used to obtain hot water services. Then here what happens is solar radiations are falling onto this absorber media or absorber plate, and so there is a radiation heat transfer from solar rays to this absorber plate. Then this absorbed heat, the heat which is absorbed from the solar radiations, is then transferred to the tubes which are in direct contact with the absorber plate, that is by conduction. So first mode is radiation, then the tubes which are in direct contact with the absorber are receiving the heat due to direct contact. These tubes are typically metallic ones, particularly copper material is used. So there is a conduction from through the pipe wall or tube which are carrying the water from in outer surface to inner surface, and water which is flowing through these tubes, it will carry the heat, it will absorb the heat from the tubes, and it will get heated up, and thereby since there is a fluid flow this part becomes a convection. This heat transfer is the mode of convection. So all three modes are clearly seen in this example. Similarly, you can find many such other examples, other applications where you can spot the type of heat transfer or mode of heat transfer. With this, let us move forward. Then the temperature, we have to discuss. We will discuss this property of a temperature in some details, and also we will see what are the how it is measured, what are the scales of temperatures available, and what are the measuring devices used to measure the temperature. So as we are talking about the heat transfer, as I have already explained to you, that for heat transfer the only condition is the temperature difference. Whenever there is a temperature difference, heat transfer will always take place, and direction of heat transfer is always from high temperature to low temperature. So this has come out from the theory of thermodynamics, rather second law of thermodynamics. And this is like a law of nature. that heat always flows from high temperature to low temperature in naturally. So this is a natural phenomenon or natural process, and that is followed by heat transfer. So it is a one-way process or one-directional process. That is why temperature, this temperature is basically a property, a thermodynamic property of any thermodynamic system, or in general, it is just a physical quantity which indicates a degree of hotness or coldness of any body or any material. Okay. So, as you can see on the slide, a typical thermometer is shown, which is known as mercury in glass tube type of a thermometer. And in this case, to measure the temperature, the extension of mercury in the tube with the rise in temperature is used. Mercury in liquid form is placed in this tube, and when this sensing bulb is put into some hot liquid or hot substance, what will happen due to absorption of heat, the temperature of this mercury will rise due to absorption of heat. And as we know that almost all materials expand or extend when they absorb the heat. So due to absorption of heat, there will be expansion of the mercury, and thereby we get to see a liquid column rising in the glass tube, and this height is proportional to the rise in temperature. So such phenomenon is used, or such process is used in temperature measurement, and this property is known as thermometric property. So extension of mercury in a glass tube is the thermometric property in this simple simple device of temperature measurement. In the same way, various other processes are also available, or various other phenomena are available which use different thermometric property. So different kinds of thermometers have been developed or have been devised by using different thermometric property. So mercury in glass, it uses the length of the liquid mercury column in the glass tube, that is extension of a liquid mercury in a glass tube. So that length, increase or decrease in length, indicates the increase or decrease in temperature. The same way we have various other types of thermometers like listed here, particularly electrical resistance thermometer, that uses the electrical parameter such as electrical resistance. There are some materials which respond to the rise or fall in temperature, or rather heat transfer processes. So their electrical resistance for some material increase with the temperature, and for some other material it may decrease with the temperature. And using that property, that is decrease or increase in resistance, will be indirectly converted to rise, to indicate rise or fall in temperature. In the same way, one more device or one more measuring sensor or measuring instrument that we know is a thermocouple. Many of you may have handled it during your diploma course. So thermocouple works on the principle of thermal EMF. So whenever thermocouple is a temperature measuring device, there are two different or dissimilar metals. They are taken together, and when they are applied, when there is a temperature difference between the two ends, due to temperature difference, the proportional EMF is generated, that is electromotive force or voltage is generated. And using this increase or decrease in the voltage generated, we can measure the temperature. We can measure the temperature. So in this way, there are various temperature measuring devices are available, and these are typically known as thermometers or temperature measuring instruments. Nowadays, as since last year, we have been experiencing the very unfortunate period of COVID-19 pandemic, and we are going through this. And as you can see on the screen, this is typically known as a thermal gun, which is used to which is used to measure the body temperature of the people from certain distance. By maintaining the physical distance or social distance and without coming in direct contact with the body of any person or patient, we can easily measure the temperature, body temperature, on this panel. As you can see here, in digital form, the temperature is available, temperature reading is available. So this is also one kind of temperature measuring instrument. In this case, the infrared principles, infrared radiations principle are used. As we have seen, in case of radiations, we don't require any material medium to travel or to pass the heat. So even though there is a huge gap, there is a large gap between this device and the human body or body of some person, still we can measure it from certain distance, let us say 2 meters or 3 meters, and without coming in direct contact. So radiation principle is used in this, and nowadays this is like a common sight. Whenever you visit some public place like hospital or railway station or hotel, anywhere, any public place, some people are there who are scanning all the visiting people just at the entry point. So you have to pass through this test, and if your body temperature is okay, then only you will be allowed to enter. Okay, so that's a simple way of measuring the body temperature of various people. Okay, so this is how different variety of temperature measuring devices are available. As an engineer, we should be aware of all these instruments or devices, and also we should be aware of what are the or what is the working principle behind it. Then let us see the temperature scales. As you already know, the temperatures are measured or expressed in degree Celsius or degree Fahrenheit. There are several scales which have been developed throughout the history, and temperature scales are very important because they enable us to actually measure the temperature. You can get some numerical value, and all these temperature scales are based on easily reproducible states through some universal natural phenomenon such as freezing and boiling points of water. It means that to fix the scale, we need some references. We need some reference points, and those reference points must be universally acceptable, and those should be universally reproducible, easily reproducible. One such common phenomenon that we know is freezing of water and boiling of water that we normally experience. And water is very common material, found everywhere, available on any location on the earth, and wherever you go, these processes are common. That is, under the atmospheric pressure, boiling, when water is cooled down, it freezes into ice. That is, it converts to a solid state. That we know as ice. And so at certain temperature, ice formation takes place. And at certain high temperature, when water is heated, and when it crosses a certain temperature, it converts to steam. So water is getting converted into steam. Steam formation takes place. So that point is taken as a high reference, and low reference is taken as a freezing of water in a ice. Okay, so one reference is low point and the other reference is high point. So very popular scales are available. Those are Celsius scale and Fahrenheit scale. Celsius scale is also used on international level as a SI unit. It is included in the international system of units. Celsius, you might be knowing this, that freezing point temperature of ice is at 0 degree Celsius and boiling temperature of water is assigned a value of 100 degree Celsius. These are just numbers, and numbers are just assigned for convenience, okay, for the measurement purpose. So we know that water will freeze at 0 degree Celsius and water will boil at 100 degree Celsius under normal atmospheric pressure. In this way, through this diagram, you can understand while developing a temperature scale or a thermometer, typical thermometer, this experiment is performed. This thermometer is placed in the mixture of ice and water, and this mark is made here, where there is a level of mercury. So that will be a 0 point or 0 degree Celsius. And when the same thermometer is put into boiling water, when there is a formation of steam, this mercury will expand and extend and will settle down at certain length or certain height. And this point will be assigned 100 degree Celsius. And this entire length will be divided into equal divisions, equal number of divisions. 0 to 100, there will be 100 divisions. And one division, one equal division will mean that that mark is a 1 degree Celsius. So in this way, we can measure, we can read the temperature on the scale provided here. The scale will be provided here. So from this 0, you can count like 1, 2, 3, 4 and so on and up to 100 degrees Celsius. The same way, you have another scale, that is Fahrenheit scale. So these scales are very popular and are being used at various locations, at various places. Fahrenheit is mostly used by British people. It was introduced by British people. So it is the part of British systems, that is inch pound system of units, where lengths are measured in feet, mass is given in pounds, for mass and weights are given in pounds, and temperature is given in Fahrenheit. It is also just another scale, just like a Celsius scale. And here also, same reference points are taken. Ice point, that is freezing temperature of water, is assigned a value of 32. These are just arbitrary numbers. We can assign any number as per our convenience. And boiling point temperature or high point reference is assigned as a 212 degree Fahrenheit. So 32 is a low point. 212 is a high point, and if we take the difference, it will be 180. So 180 divisions are there on a Fahrenheit scale. So 180 equal divisions will be made on this scale, and with the help of scale, we can easily read the temperature. So Celsius and Fahrenheit. For our study, whatever calculations we are going to do or whatever problems we are going to solve, all those will be in degree Celsius or Kelvin scale. Fahrenheit we will not use. We will not use in calculations. Then another temperature scale is a Kelvin scale, which is also known as the absolute temperature scale. It has come out from the requirement of a thermodynamics. In thermodynamics, it is desirable to have a temperature scale which is independent of any substance. We should not depend. Temperature is a universal property. So idea is that it should not depend on any material like water. So it should be completely free of any such substance. So such temperature scale is known as thermodynamic temperature scale. And it is expressed in Kelvin. So Kelvin scale is the SI unit or international unit for absolute temperature. So degree Celsius and Kelvin will be used for our study or for our handle certain problems. The lowest temperature on Kelvin scale is absolute zero, that is 0 Kelvin. So there is no any negative value in Kelvin. All the values that you get on Kelvin scale are all positive. There is no There is nothing like a negative or minus Kelvin. So zero is the lowest, and all the measurement will start from zero Kelvin. Otherwise, in degree Celsius and degree Fahrenheit, negative temperatures are possible when temperature is well below 0 degrees Celsius or well below freezing point temperature of water. Normally, such conditions exist at the places like polar region on the Earth, and there are some countries such as Canada, Northern America, Northern Europe, Russia. All these fall under, all these come under very cold regions or cold zones, and in winter, very low temperatures are experienced, like minus 30 degrees Celsius, minus 40 degrees Celsius. So minus there we have to deal with negative temperatures. But in Kelvin scale, we need not to worry about negative. Everything will be positive. So Kelvin scale is related to degrees Celsius with this relation. Kelvin equal to temperature in degree Celsius plus 273. So whatever is degree Celsius available, we have to add 273 number, then you get temperature in Kelvin. So freezing temperature, ice point will be 273 Kelvin, that is 0 degree Celsius, and boiling point temperature, that is 100 degree Celsius, 100 plus 273, it will be 373 Kelvin. Again, we get 100 divisions on scale. So if you look at the difference, the temperature, degree Celsius scale and Kelvin scale, both are very equivalent to each other, because both have 100 divisions on their scale, and thereby the unit temperature difference will always numerically be equal. Then Fahrenheit scale, it is just for your general knowledge that Fahrenheit can be converted to degree Celsius using this relation. Degree Fahrenheit equal to 1.8 in degree Celsius plus 32. This way you can convert from degree Fahrenheit to degree Celsius. Then if we compare all three scales on one diagram, so this way they can be indicated. So Kelvin scale, that is ice point, is 273, steam point 373, difference is 100 Kelvin. Same is the case with degree Celsius, 0 degree Celsius on low side, 100 degree Celsius on high side, and difference is 100 degree Celsius. For Fahrenheit, 32 is the low point, 212 is the high point, delta TV is 180 degrees Fahrenheit. Then relation between degree Kelvin and degree Celsius, already explained to you that since difference is the same, each division of 1 Kelvin and 1 degree Celsius are identical. Therefore, temperature differences in Kelvin is numerically equal to delta T in Celsius. That is, delta T in Kelvin equal to delta T in degrees Celsius. So, whenever we use delta T in formula of heat transfer, as long as it is a temperature difference, it will be immaterial whether you use in Kelvin scale or degree Celsius scale. Whatever unit you use, if delta T is there, delta T will still be the same. Just like here, 373 minus 273 is 100. In the same way, 100 minus 0 is 100. So delta T numerically is the same. But we have to be careful when we are handling with absolute temperatures. Only when there is only temperature in any formula, in that case we have to go for absolute temperature scale. Particularly we have to be very careful when we handle radiation part. When we handle the equations of radiation, the terms like T raised to 4 and T raised to 2 will appear. And in that case, we have to use Kelvin scale. All those aspects and details will be clear when we actually take into the radiation part. So you need not to worry about it right now. But this is just for a general precaution. Okay. Same. Okay. Okay. All these things are already explained. Various temperature measuring instruments, a list is given here. liquid in glass thermometer. It is still being used in at many places, and particularly in laboratories, that you will find. Even since it is a mechanical type of mechanical device, and still we use it at our home just to check our body temperature whenever we get a high fever. So this is quite a common item at various homes. We have this at our home. A biometallic strip is there. It uses the thermal expansion property of dissimilar metals. Okay, we need not to go into the details of this. Just you should have idea of how many temperature measuring devices are there. So biometallic strip is one of them. Sealed bellows. It is filled with some gas that will respond to the changes in temperature. It will either get compressed or it will get expand, and according to it, its change in volume will be indicated in as a rise or fall in temperature. Then bulb and capillary sensor, many such devices have been developed. The thermocouple is very important one, and whatever experiments we are going to see in the laboratory part of heat transfer, for heat transfer we are having a separate course or separate subject of laboratory or experiments practical session for heat transfer. In that we are going to see 8 to 10 different experiments, and in all those experiments temperature measurement is the integral part, and for those temperature measurements we will be dealing with thermocouples. So thermocouple is very simple device, very readily available in the market, and also available at low cost. It's when two dissimilar metals are connected together, a small voltage is generated at the junction, and this is called a Peltier effect. So it works on the Peltier effect. Here you can see in the diagram, two dissimilar metals are taken, metal A, metal B. Those are connected at this, forming a junction, and when it is applied to sense the temperature, a proportional change in voltage is generated at the other end. Okay. Then a digital temperature indicator will be used. The thermocouples are sensors, and this is indicator, temperature indicator, because the signal we will get, it will be in the form of electrical voltage. And using the sensors and transducers and some suitable electronic circuit, that voltage signal will be amplified, and that will be converted to some electrical parameter, and that will be displayed on this digital display board, digital display, where you directly get to see the numerical value of temperature. The voltage is directly converted in the units of temperature. So some electronics is involved behind this, that circuitry and everything, all those things will be encased in this temperature indicator box. We need not go into that detail of what electronics and how it is amplified and all. Only we just we are concerned, or we are interested in the measurement point or measurement junction where it is applied, and what value we are getting on the display. Then the rest of the things is just wiring and connections. Then resistance temperature devices, that is, these are known as RTDs. These also work on thermoelectrical thermoelectrical effect, and these will be used where very precise measurement of temperature is required. Again, these are only occasionally used where it is required to measure with a great precision and great accuracy. Okay. Then Now we move on to the main part of our course, that is Fourier's law of heat conduction. Before that, just let me see how many are there. Okay. Fourier's law of heat conduction. Yesterday we have seen the mode of heat transfer as a conduction. That conduction happens in mostly it happens in solid matter. It also happens in liquids and gases, but it is predominantly seen in solids. So for example, let us take this brick wall. If you look at the wall section of your any room or any house, you will find this much is the thickness, and suppose this is the outer face of the wall and this is inner face of the wall, and across this thickness as shown here of 30 centimeter, and due to temperature difference of this face is at 20 degrees Celsius and this face is at 5 degrees Celsius. So 20 minus 5, 15 degrees Celsius temperature difference is available. So heat will be conducted from this face to this face, from left face to right face. Because as there is a temperature difference, heat will naturally always flow from high temperature to low temperature. And this, in this case, it will happen by conduction. And for this, to derive the formula for the rate of heat transfer, that is to find how much heat transfer is occurring for this brick wall with these temperatures. For that matter, we need to devise or we need to derive a formula, and that will be given by Fourier's law. It is famously known as Fourier's law of heat conduction. Now consider the situation like this. As you can see in this diagram, now see, as you can see, this diagram shows only two dimensions, that is this thickness and this height. But if you look at the wall is a three-dimensional object. So on paper we can draw like this. This is x-axis, positive x-axis. This is y-axis. So this is the thickness seen here. This is the height of the wall, and this is the length of the wall, which is perpendicular to the plane of paper. It will be perpendicular to the plane of paper. So this entire face, this which is having the area A, which is having area A, this face and this face, this area A is of this right face. The same area will appear for left face, and both are perpendicular to the plane of paper. And let us say both are at temperatures, different temperatures. Left face is at temperature T1 and right face is at temperature T2. Okay, and there is a temperature difference such that T1 is greater than T2. So T1 minus T2 temperature difference is available. Now let us see, let us take the positive x-axis. It is starting with this reference. 0 is set at the left face, and for a differential value, let us take only dx amount of width. For dx amount of width in this positive direction, temperature difference available is dt, is T1 minus T2, and heat transfer is occurring by conduction. Let us say Q, capital Q is the rate of heat transfer by conduction, and it is passing through this wall across this thickness dx. this then quantity that is temperature difference dt divided by width dx, this quantity is known as temperature gradient in x direction. Temperature gradient in x direction, it means that rate of change of temperature with respect to x or with respect to direction. Now with this, the statement of Fourier's law is like this: rate of heat conduction, that is Q, is in a particular direction, that is in positive direction x, is directly proportional to the area normal to the direction of heat transfer and temperature gradient in that direction. So rate of heat transfer is directly proportional, so mathematically we can write rate of heat transfer Q is directly proportional to this area A, which is normal to the direction of heat transfer. Now see, direction of heat transfer is along positive x, and area which is normal or perpendicular, it means this area here shown, area is in which is perpendicular to this direction. So rate of heat transfer is proportional to this area, not this cross sectional area. See, this cross sectional area is different and this area is different. Area which is normal or perpendicular to the direction of heat transfer, and temperature gradient in that direction, in the direction of heat transfer, temperature gradient is dt by dx. So mathematically we can write Q equal to minus Ka dt by dx. This proportionality is removed and minus K is introduced. Area in SI units, rate of heat transfer will be in watt, area will be in meter square, and dt by dx, temperature gradient in heat transfer, will be in dt is temperature difference, so it will have units of either Kelvin or degree Celsius, doesn't matter. So you can use Kelvin or you can use degree Celsius, and dx is a distance, so SI unit is meter. The temperature gradient will have units of Kelvin per meter or degree Celsius per meter. Now this constant of proportionality K is known as thermal conductivity of material. So here we have got a new property of a material which has direct relation to conduction heat transfer. Then, so this K is known as thermal conductivity of materials, and it will have SI units of watt per meter Kelvin. It can be shown like this. We can rewrite this equation. Q equal to, basic equation is this: Q equal to minus Ka dt by dx. We are writing it for K, so K equal to minus Q. All the other parameters on right hand side are taken to the denominator, so minus Q over A into dt by dx. So Q is in watt, area in meter square, dt by dx is Kelvin per meter, so meter to meter one get cancelled, what remains is watt per meter Kelvin. So in this way we obtain the units for K or units for thermal conductivity. So it is a physical property of any material which indicates the ability of material to conduct the heat, that is ability of any material that so it's a high value of K will indicate a material is having high conduction, higher ability to conduct the heat, or very it can transfer the heat at a quicker rate or at a faster rate, or with very easily it can conduct the heat. On the other hand, if numerical value of K is very low, it indicates that ability of that material to conduct the heat is very low. So thermal conductivity is defined as the rate of heat conduction through unit area, that is unit area, when unit temperature gradient exists. It's just a mathematical definition of conductivity K. Then materials with high values of K, which have very high values of K, are known as thermal conductors. And such type of materials allow very easy and faster heat transfer through them. Generally, metals are very excellent thermal conductors. That is why you find So many applications have been developed with the help of metals. All the cooking appliances, cooling or heating coils, wherever we need to transfer the heat at a very high rate, we always go with the metals. Okay, so metals are always used. Then these are the assumptions made in Fourier's law of heat conduction while deriving this equation. Very important assumption is steady state condition, that is, heat transfer is occurring at steady state. Steady state means the property such as temperature will not change. Property such as the temperature as well as the rate of heat transfer will not change with respect to time. Then heat transfer is unidirectional. Here we have considered only this positive x direction. Then temperature gradient is also constant because temperatures are constant and the temperature profile is linear. Then for material, it is a homogeneous and isotropic. It means that the value of thermal conductivity is constant in all directions. And there is no any internal heat generation, and the surfaces, the bounding surfaces, are isothermal in character. So these are the specific assumptions for deriving this equation. And here we have to note that a negative sign is shown in a basic equation, that Q equal to minus Ka dT by dx. So why this negative sign has come into picture? This is because the mathematical or numerical value of dT by dx, this term is there, dT by dx, this will be negative. This will be negative because in the direction of x, in the positive direction of x, the distance is increasing from 0 to x, 0 to positive x. So dx will be positive, denominator is positive, but in numerator you see temperature is decreasing from T1 to T2. So if you take the difference, like T2 minus T1, it will be negative. So this whole quantity dT by dx will be negative. That is why all the right hand side will be negative. And since heat is the energy, and the energy cannot be negative, it may be either zero or it may be it will have some finite and positive quantity. So there is no meaning. There is no meaning of saying that there is a negative heat. So positive negative is just indication of a direction. So to make this entire quantity of Q, to make this positive, we have introduced this negative sign. So dT by dx numerically will be negative. So negative into negative will turn into positive. So whole Q will be a positive quantity. So this is just a mathematical adjustment, so that all the answers will be in positive form or positive finite value. Then this thermal conductivity K, let us look at some examples or some values. So the materials with very high value of conductivity are good conductors of heat. I mentioned that all the metals are always good conductors of heat. Metals such as copper, aluminum, brass, steel, even some alloys, all have very high thermal conductivity values, and these are being used in heating and cooling applications for higher heat transfer rates. Okay, so these will have a very high value of conductivity, particularly in metals. Copper and aluminum are known for high thermal conductivities. In this table you can see the values of K, general values of K. Copper is 400 watt per meter Kelvin, and the same aluminum is about 250. It ranges between 230 to 250 watt per meter degree Celsius or watt per meter Kelvin. both have very high values of thermal conductivity. Silver and gold, which are normally used in jewelry and ornaments, which are not these are not used for engineering applications because these are very costly, as well as they are very what I can say, their strength is not so, these are not stronger elements, stronger components, so we cannot use them for any engineering application. But still they have very high conductivity, as you can see by these numbers. Silver about 430 watt per meter Kelvin, and gold is having around 300-320 watt per meter Kelvin. Similarly, iron is there. Cast iron we mostly use for construction of most of the mechanical devices, particularly the IC engine bodies are made out of cast iron. Cylinder block, cylinder head are made of cast irons. It is having conductivity of 80-100 in the range of 80-100 watt per meter Kelvin. Steel is again alloy, so it will have in the same range, it will have the thermal conductivity. The same fashion you can go for, you can look for some other materials from such table. Such data tables are available from any reference, any heat transfer reference book or any heat transfer data book. You will find all the required values. Then there are some materials which have very poor conductivity or very very low conductivity. Such materials are known as poor conductors of heat, and typically these are termed as insulators, because these will block the heat transfer. These will not allow the heat transfer to occur very easily. So they will provide certain resistance, very high resistance to heat flow. So that is why these are known as insulators or are known for their poor conductivity. And these insulators are also having some applications. Whenever we want to, or we want to prevent the heat losses, we have to go for insulating materials. Suppose in a boiler and power plant, there is a steam pipe which is taking the steam from boiler to turbine or some other device, and it has to cover longer distance through the pipe. Of course, steel pipe will be used to carry such a hot medium at high pressure and high temperature. Okay, so steam will be at very high pressure and high temperature, and if it is being carried in a steel pipe. And if this steel pipe is just exposed to the surrounding air or ambient air, which is at much lower temperature, the steam will lose its heat, because of high conductivity of steel pipe. So in such case, what will happen? All the steam will lose its heat and its temperature will come down, and in some cases it will condense to water, and we certainly don't want it to happen, because to generate a steam, we have already spent so much of energy, and we have burnt very valuable fuel such as coal or oil or gas. And if we don't provide any, if we don't prevent this heat loss from the steam pipe, it will be all a wastage. It will be a wastage of, money. It will be wastage of energy, useful energy, as well as money, because for fuels we have to pay a lot, and that will be a direct economical loss. So to prevent all such losses, the steam pipe will be covered by some material such as insulation. And insulating materials are like thermocol, asbestos, polyurethane foam, mineral wool, and many other are there. So these will typically have very low thermal conductivity, as you can see here. Glass fiber is just one of the examples. So it is having a conductivity at 0.043, well below 1, and even lesser than 0.1. Okay. So this is how you have to we have to understand the difference between highly conducting materials and poorly conducting materials, and what are their uses and applications, and how to select them to suit particular applications or particular cases. Then, as I said, so far we discussed only for solids, conductivity of solids. Conductivity or conduction is also possible through liquids and gases. Liquids and gases are also composed of atoms and molecules. And mechanism. Yesterday we have seen the mechanism of conduction, that conduction occurs due to lattice vibrations. That is, there is an interaction between molecule to molecule or atom to atom. And also there is a flow of free electrons in case of metals. And the same happens in liquids and gases also, but the effect is very marginal or very minimal, because in case of solids, atoms and molecules are very, very close to each other. The distance is very, very small. That is why their atoms and molecules are in direct contact with each other, and they can easily conduct the heat. They can pass the heat through their vibrations. But in case of liquids and gases, the molecules are much away from each other, and in case of gases, they are farther away from each other. Distances are very, very long, and due to this, due to very large gap between one molecule to another molecule, or one atom to another atom, the conduction phenomenon is very weak in case of liquids and gases. And that is why the conductivity, thermal conductivity values of liquids and gases will be very, very low. For comparison, I have given some values here. For pure metals, you see K ranges from about 10 to 400. For alloys, alloys are again metallic solids, so they are between 10 to 120 to 150. Insulators are again solid materials, but they are non-metals. Such as wood, rubber, plastic, etc. They have very, very low conductivity, such as 0.023 to up to 3 watt per meter Kelvin. If you take this to liquids, K is ranging between 0.2 to 0.6. So generally, K for liquids is below 1, below a unity. Then for gases, it is much lesser. That is, it is ranging between 0.006 to 0.1. So this way, generally, you can give K of solids greater than K of liquids and K of gases. Then thermal conductivity of particularly solid materials depend on these many factors. That is, material structure. It depends on the microstructures. Microstructure or metallographic structure of any material. Then moisture contents, because some materials such as wood, paper, asbestos, these can absorb water. These can absorb water, and there will be a presence of water. So that also affects the conductivity value. Then density of materials. Some materials have high density, some materials are low density. So thermal conductivity will certainly depend on density. Then operating temperature and pressure. Like some materials operate at room temperature, while some other materials which have to operate at very high temperature, such as in boilers. Boilers, as there is a combustion of fuel, so heat, lot of heat is generated, and temperatures are more than 1000 degrees Celsius. In case of furnaces also, temperatures are of very high order. Similarly, in case of boilers, when steam pressure is very high, above 100 bar or so, so the materials such as cast iron or alloy steel will have different thermal conductivity operating at those higher pressure and temperature. With this, we will stop our discussion for today's class, and we will carry on from this point onwards. Let me just take your attendance, and then you can depart. wait for a few seconds. It will be recorded and downloaded. Okay, I think it is done. Okay, you can depart and please join on in the next we will now meet in next week. Okay, thank you.